Well, it's a little bit dangerous for me to be up here without a moderator, but I'll try to not take up too much of your time towards the end now that we're all getting tired. You remember this slide? I showed this yesterday at the very beginning, and I hope we've accomplished this. I think, at least from my perspective, I've certainly been well informed now from what I've heard. I hope we've also achieved the second aim, and that was to inspire you. And I think especially this last session and the session before really added to that. But that's not enough. I think we really, for those of us who aren't fully engaged, now is the time to really get engaged in this process. And I hopefully we've given you a number of reasons to do that. This has been an unusual meeting, as I bet you've realized. And maybe that's why you came as well. But the intention was to make it very, very unusual. So, as you know, at other scientific meetings and other non-scientific meetings, you're often amongst your quote-unquote own element, speaking within your own group. But we intentionally wanted this to be a meeting of opportunities to interface and interact with those who you might not normally interact with at a scientific or non-scientific meeting. And I'll just say as an example, for the basic research community, we may not, and I'll include that myself in that, we may not always be thinking of the patient who is the ultimate outcome of the research that we're doing. So I think it's it was intentional to do it this way. We had numerous different communities, disciplines, fields represented at this, and I hope it was successful in that way. And our overall goal, what to do, was to begin to talk about and to get engaged in how do we integrate modeling systems into the precision medicine paradigm. We've come a long way. And in fact, a little bit, a few years before President Obama and Francis Collins with the Precision in Medicine Initiative, we had Hippocrates that already introduced the idea of what person the disease has as opposed to what disease the person has. So kind of an indication of it, this is more personalized in terms of health. And then really, you'll have clinicians and veterinarians too saying, well, we've been practicing precision medicine all along. I mean, look, we're prescribing eyeglasses for a precise fee for an individual or blood types, or even the way a fracture comes in for reduction in surgery will be very precise to the patient. But we're moving on to something else, as we all know, and that is the gathering of, no longer is it called big data, but it's really enormous data in order to inform how we move forward. But we've got a long way to go. And so I just put 4 points up here about things to consider as we begin to think about how we can integrate modeling and precision medicine. This growth in translation of research has increased the incidence of really poorly predictive animal models, and that speaks to the rigor and reproducibility challenges which we continue to face. There have been modest gains in treatment successes and slow and expensive drug pipelines that fail in diverse patient populations. This is the quote-unquote valley of death. We also know that genotype to mechanism to phenotype is not as easy as it was once thought. And you consider pleiotropy, heterogeneity, variable penetrance, sexual dimorphism, and other things. And then finally, the exponentially increasing number of variants as a result of people getting their genome sequenced. You get variants of unknown significance and a lack of sufficient specific biomarkers of disease. We run into problems with being able to assign causation from correlation, distinguish causation from correlation, or taking disease genes and identifying disease alleles. So the ultimate objective of incorporating model organisms into precision medicine is to overcome bottlenecks to positive health outcomes in patients. And those are three bottlenecks. One is the timely and accurate disease diagnosis in humans, understanding disease mechanism at systems level, and predictable, reliable, and effective therapeutic response. But it's not just humans. It's veterinary medicine too. And in fact, no less than Bob Califf yesterday introduced veterinary medicine in his presentation. And as indicated here from an article a year or two ago, there's many reasons why the veterinary profession can be involved as well. So the utility of model organisms in precision medicine really depends on their predictive value, and I'm going to posit the proximity to the patient. We have basic researchers doing wonderful work. We have the applied researchers who are developing animal models, and even the models with genetic variants mimicking patients. But how close can we get to the clinical bedside? Of course, all of this is translational research, but really, how close to that edge can we get in order for the clinician there sitting next to their patient can really benefit from all of this information? And I'm going to take one slide from all of your presentations And David, I will thank you. I don't know if David's still here, but I'm going to thank Dr. Valley for this, is to highlight what I believe is the model organism value proposition. And that is they can be used to confirm causation, to understand pathophysiology, and to be used as surrogates for treatment studies. So how can model organisms enhance precision medicine? Well, I put this table together to try to quantify it as best I can. I look at four factors here, and this is what occurs without modeling, with modeling. Well, certainly observation, history taking, and interaction with the patient. You could certainly do that without modeling, and of course with modeling. Data integration, I put a plus minus because if you look at just the pure approach that's posed for precision medicine, the data integration is really using human data, maybe some cell data and so on, but certainly it's greatly extended than with data across phenotype, across model organisms. Experimental interrogation, well, there is none without modeling, and of course there is with modeling, and what I posit is then the intervention, and that is then the actions that you can take for a patient. Certainly you can do that without modeling, but I posit that it can be greatly expanded and improved with modeling. All right, so here's a very, very simple algorithm, probably way too simple, to show how that model organisms can be incorporated in patient-specific precision medicine using animal model or modeling organisms. So starting here with the medical record, mobile sensors, omics and self-reporting, you have data integration that leads to statistical inference, and finally, hopefully, clinical interpretation that hopefully is immediately actionable. Whoops, I really messed that up. That we hope is immediately actionable, but for those that are only potentially actionable, this is where I think in vivo modeling could come in with patient-derived avatars, computational cross-species mapping, as well as the systems level phenotyping. Again, with the idea of how close can we get it to the clinical bedside. And we hope that eventually we can then make those clinically actionable. But it's not gonna be so easy because this is a slide taken from the Monarch group who's done, I think, probably, they're at the leading edge of being medical translators, being able to translate the language of what we do in the laboratory to the clinic and then back again. I think without them, we'd be lost. So I asked to use this slide because this shows that despite what looks simple, integrating diverse data sets using phenotypes to achieve a diagnosis is going to be difficult. And that difficulty arises because of different communities speaking their own lexicons, phenotype profile matching, the relevance of pathways and models across species, gene orthologies, and inference. But hopefully what we've done is we've begun the discussion and we'll continue the interaction as we move forward together to incorporate modeling into the precision medicine paradigm. So what can we expect? What should our expectations be if we move forward together with this? Well, I've listed a few here that I think we should expect. And maybe these are again also too simplistic, expecting too much, but the vision is the future, and so we don't have to put a timeline on these. But I would hope to think that we could then define disease pathogenesis in context, meaning with the characteristics of the patient in mind context. Disease causation, not only simple Mendelian, but also complex diseases. Understanding the role of environmental and other external challenges. Understanding how the relative influence and impact of behaviors and lifestyles. Illuminating the druggable genome, meaning we would have an illuminated druggable genome. We would have a diagnosed disease network emerging from the undiagnosed disease network. We would have targeted therapies and improve therapeutic effectiveness, and perhaps really in the long term, improving prevention strategies. And what I mean by that is delaying the onset and or the progression of an individual from becoming a patient. Okay, so last few slides. Here are some calls to action that I've come up with as a result of this meeting and hearing you today. The first is, it seems clear that we need to take baby steps before we can take the giant leaps, and those baby steps are based on knowledge and information. And that knowledge and information, at least what we're talking about here, needs to come from a complete and comprehensive encyclopedic functional annotation of the genome. And I As you know, we've been espousing the idea that it's not just human data, but this is data-driven, but it's just not only human data, it's cross-species data. It requires experimentation, and that experimentation can be both descriptive screening as well as hypothesis testing. It's beyond the protein coding region, too. We really focused on the coding sequence, but what about non-coding variants? What about regulatory regions, microRNAs, and others? And also, we need to unveil pleiotropy, sexual dimorphism, and essentiality, or those essential genes. Two, we need to formalize linkages between model organism communities and databases with precision medicine initiatives. Now, that will allow for crosstalk ontologies and comparative phenotyping. This will allow for model identification and improving nomenclature and the description of these models, and establishing a formal relationship with the All of Us program, which I just received an email about an hour ago from Petra Kaufman saying that she'd like to initiate that as soon as possible. So it looks like we've accomplished one of our goals from this calls to action already. Thirdly, enhance processes and expand availability of tools to apply comparative ontologies and develop computable phenotypes. So this allows us to align phenotype to mechanism and to genotype. Knowing disease genes will be essential in order to prioritize the disease alleles that we're going to be, which we are now sequencing in patients. This will also enable us to secure scientific rigor, reproducibility, and reliability, and also keeping in mind the arrived guidelines and camarades. Four, integrating animal ontologies with in vitro analyses, the humans on a chip, and patient data to identify knowledge gaps that propel precision modeling of specific human variants. This will allow us to accelerate distinguishing correlated from causal factors, optimizing the selection of a particular model organism for analysis. That includes including spontaneous models and pet species and so on. We need to pay attention to welfare issues, ethical issues, and the three R's, and it'll also help improve decision-making for better evidence and less noise. We need to promote, incentivize, and reward a culture of synergistic, clinical outcomes-focused networks and collaborations between translational researchers, clinician scientists, and patient groups. So this means working in preclinical and co-clinical trials, working towards the regulatory dream that Robert talked about yesterday, and on a focus on health outcomes and disease prevention. We need to expand model organism resources and technology development for rapid assessment of variants. So this includes adding or enhancing these MOSC-like or GEM-like activities that we heard about today, expanding, augmenting, enhancing biorepositories and tissue specimen banks, improving the phenotypic validation testing capabilities, improving anatomic, clinical, and molecular pathologies, maybe looking at MOD, and another definition or something else that MOD stands for besides model organism database would be model on demand, and also then ensuring the predictive validity of models. Seventh, to establish clinical utility of a precision, and I use that phrase carefully, establish clinical utility of a precision modeling paradigm to advance and accelerate diagnostic decision making, targeted therapeutic development, and predictable disease prevention strategies. And eighth, to ensure the accessibility of resources, tools, and networks of precision modelers to the global community. So that way we can transcend cultural and socioeconomic divisions, reduce and overcome disparities, increase access, increase opportunities, and also to promote science education, skills training, and community outreach. So with that, I want to really extend my thanks, and I'll also speak for my co-chair, Brian Barrage, and the entire committee. A real heartfelt thank you to all of the speakers who came, many from very far places, as well as all the attendees, both in person and online. So thank you very much.